Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi on this episode of Insight, Relationships of Convenience, when they work and when they don't.
There were sperm donors available online for all different reasons.
We got it on Gumtree.
It was a bit of that convenient relationship at first. We were establishing boundaries.
Were you in love?
Well, I was attracted to him.
A lot of my relationships are transactional.
So what was it like subleasing a room from your former wife?
Not ideal, but it had its conveniences.
Stacey, 5 years ago, you were a single mum with a three-year-old daughter. Where were you living at that time?
So I was living in a one-bedroom granny flat with my daughter at the time after I was recently separated.
And about 8 months after that, you were given a notice to vacate.
Yeah.
Where did that leave you and your daughter, Halo?
It was really quite stressful because the news came out of the blue and I'd never, the thought of finding a lease on my own, financially, how that would look, how I'd look on paper, it was really quite daunting. I didn't really know where to start at all.
How did you feel about that?
It was stressful. I honestly didn't know how I was going to make it work.
A friend then made a suggestion to you. What was it?
Well, she just said in passing, have you ever considered, you know, living with someone else? I've actually got another friend who's moving to the Sunshine Coast, and it hadn't even contemplated it because I thought, you know, I've got a child now. I mean, I'd flattered in my 20s with other people, but I didn't think that was something you did when you had a child. But at that point, I was quite desperate, so I was open to anything.
So you decided to say yes to this option. Did that house sharing become a convenient situation for you?
Oh, absolutely. It was life-changing in a beautiful way.
Nikki, you were also a single mum at the time with a young daughter.
Mm-hmm.
Where were you two living at that time?
We were living in Mackay in North Queensland, and I'd already taken a job on the Sunshine Coast, so I had to very quickly find somewhere to live.
What did you think when your mutual friend suggested that you move in with someone that you didn't know?
I was like, how would that work? My daughter is full of energy, so I guess the concern was I going to bring my child into someone else's life and create chaos or havoc for them? I do like my own space, so moving in with someone, there was a concern. We would have to have a place that was big enough to facilitate us both having enough space for each other and for our children as well. So, yeah, that was definitely a fear moving in.
And what about your parenting kind of being in the spotlight of someone else?
Oh, yeah, that was definitely something, definitely something that crossed my mind. At that time, my daughter was 8, so I'd been doing it by myself for 7 years. No one really looking at my parenting under a microscope, so... Having someone there every single day for every single moment was a little bit daunting, yeah.
What appealed to you about the proposition?
Oh, I think the most appealing part was that we could pool our resources and get somewhere that was actually really functional for us and create this beautiful home on the Sunshine Coast rather than moving into a tiny little butterbox of a unit.
Did you actually meet Stacey in person before you decided to go ahead?
Nope, we did not meet before. We'd spoken once on the phone and then daily text messages backwards and forwards as we were looking for a house.
So after that initial phone call, the two of you and your daughters moved in together. How did your household operate, Nikki?
Well, at first it was, I guess, because it was a bit of that convenient relationship at first, we were establishing boundaries, so we were slightly living our own lives and just slowly intertwining. But within a matter of weeks, we sort of very much fell into, I guess, shared roles within the household. Stacey loves to cook and clean and I love to mow the lawn, so it worked out well.
Stacey, it felt pretty seamless to you.
Yeah, it was beautiful, yeah.
So you and Nikki, Stacey, weren't just flatmates. You were also basically parenting together in a way. How did you approach that?
Well, we were really lucky that we shared really similar values, so it never felt hard. We backed each other up, we supported each other, we took turns of looking after each other's children, and so it just all fell into place really perfectly.
Did you feel like you could kind of pull the other person's child up?
Yeah, absolutely. Yep, and it was done really lovingly, really beautifully. Mm. We had such similar values, so we just, you know, we were about talking to the girls and, yeah, so it...
So your daughters were 8 and 3 when you moved in together. How did they get on?
Like normal siblings. They got on like a house on fire and they fought really well too.
Stacey, what did other people think of your living situation?
I definitely had a few friends with some concerns, like worried, well, how is this going to look? You don't know each other. What if it goes terribly wrong? Where are you going to be? But I was at a pretty desperate point, so I went in with a really positive mindset and open mind, and we made it work really beautifully.
Was this a convenient relationship for you both?
Yeah, it was extremely convenient financially, socially, emotionally. It was really supportive.
Nikki, for you?
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. The convenience of all of those things definitely helped our lives.
For some, a convenient way to date but without the emotional connection is known as a sugar baby, sugar daddy relationship. Here's Trudy's story.
For me, the most convenient parts of a sugar relationship was knowing where I stood, not having to be romantically engaged, and to be honest, the money and gifts were great. It's definitely a relationship of convenience. I love the fact that with a sugar baby and a sugar daddy, you meet before anything happens and you sit down and you have a conversation around expectations, around your boundaries, your hard limits, a yes, what's a no. The time you're expecting to devote to this particular relationship. So to find a sugar daddy, I did a bit of Google, did a bit of research, and went on to Seeking Arrangements, the website. And I was looking for somebody who was a little bit older than me, had some maturity behind them, and hopefully some old school manners and a level of respect. I was originally attracted to sugar relationships because I'd actually come out of a one-year relationship after finding out that he had been seeing somebody else the whole time. And then I had to close down my business. So I was in this headspace of feeling like everything was just out of control, and becoming a sugar baby, it seemed like a quite sensible step for me. I met a sugar daddy when I was in Sydney, and we went out, we had dinner, we chatted like friends, then we sort of moved into the more intimate side of that. But we sat up talking, and it wasn't just a wham bam thank you ma'am. The sugar daddy paid me $2,000. But for me that felt like appreciation, and that was what I set as a boundary. There had to be appreciation and there had to be value for both of us, just not love. There's a lot of stigma attached to this kind of relationship. People call it sex work, people call it abuse, manipulation. It gets a really bad rap. You're selling yourself for sex, but I feel it's more than just sex. The difference from being an escort versus a sugar baby is an amazing sugar daddy will be mentoring you, supporting you in your development, sharing life experience. I feel zero shame about being a sugar baby. Why would I? I felt whole, I felt seen, I felt appreciated, and I felt valued. And then I ended up meeting somebody when I was actually ready for a serious relationship, and I was healed. And so the convenient part of it didn't work anymore.
Katia, you had a lunch date today. Who was that with?
So I had a lunch date in my break at work with a very beautiful young man. We had some lunch together. We had a good conversation.
So you go out for lunch together. Is this a mutually beneficial relationship?
Yes, it was a very mutually beneficial professional relationship that we have. He pays me money and I give him my company.
These kinds of setups can be called sugar baby and sugar daddy dating. Is that how you see it?
I don't self-identify as a sugar baby at the moment. I identify as a sex worker, but I guess you could say that what I do does have elements of sugaring in it. When you're sugaring, it's more of a relationship based on experiences, gifts, and an allowance-based payment system. So while I, may not identify as a sugar baby, what I do may be perceived as that.
Are these relationships convenient for you?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I saw him on my lunch break. That's pretty convenient. I got lunch paid for me. I got presents. I had a really nice conversation and I got paid.
So the convenience ultimately, would it be the money for you?
For me, it's not just about the money. Obviously, the money is great and I wouldn't do it if there was no money involved, but I really seek clients who I have an emotional connection with as well. So I really enjoy spending time with people and I enjoy getting to know things about them. And I think for me, I want the clients to also feel that way about me. I want them to respect me and to appreciate and be attracted to me just, for my looks, but also my brain.
Do you think there's a level of convenience for your dates, for your clients?
Yeah, definitely. I offer a range of different services, so whether that's more of a physical intimate service or whether it's dates and conversation, or it could be both.
How are those relationships different from other relationships in your life?
I really feel like a lot of my relationships are transactional. I think giving and receiving is a part of all relationships, and I think we receive and give different things to different people. So while I might be getting money and gifts and nice things from my clients, I also have a really loving, beautiful personal partner at home. I might say, oh babe, can you give me a massage? And then my partner will say, okay, but only if you give me a back tickle, you know. So I feel like there is, and that doesn't mean that I don't enjoy giving my partner a back tickle or they don't enjoy massaging me. It just means we're giving and taking together. And I think that's part of a normal sense, and I guess with my clients, the exchange currency is cash.
Jasmine, in 2017, you started looking for a man. Was that for romance?
No, it wasn't. It was for someone to help me make a baby, a sperm donor.
And why did you go down that path?
Because I couldn't find romance. And I thought I was getting a little old. According to Western Med, I was close to being a geriatric if I wanted to have a baby at 36. I hadn't met anyone and I didn't want to meet someone just for that purpose, get into a relationship that just didn't seem very smart, not knowing someone very well and having a baby with them, you know.
And having always wanted a baby, when men realised that you might have been dating, did they react to that?
Yes, they would run away.
Why?
If you're going on dates with some men and it's early days and as a woman you talk about a baby or that's your dream or desire, that freaks a lot of men out. It was too much for them to hear that, even though I would express, look, it's not with you necessarily, but this is my dream and this is my mission.
Did you want a relationship with the donor?
Certainly the way I chose to find a donor, I didn't do IVF. I chose to go online and find a donor that way for financial reasons. So, and also the reason was so I did know the donor, so I could meet the donor in real life and suss him and get a feel for him. And so that I knew that my child could meet him. I wanted that transparency for my child.
Had you always imagined, though, the parenting to be a solo thing?
Absolutely,
for you?
Yeah.
So just talk us through how you went through finding a donor.
I found through talking to different people that I had experienced different ways of becoming a mother, I found out that there was a way that you didn't have to do IVF, that there were sperm donors available online. So there's all different websites with profiles of men for all different reasons wanting to donate their sperm. So I decided to check that route out.
And was it more convenient for you searching online rather than going through a sperm bank?
Yeah, I believe it was, because when I did look into sperm banks, it's still an IVF kind of method that you have to use and it's very expensive and they don't have very many donors on their lists. And you can't see the person, you only get a small description and it's a very short list. So I preferred to know a bit more about the donor.
So at the start of this journey, did it seem kind of quite simple to you?
Yeah, I guess it seemed kind of simple, yeah. Obviously a little unusual, it wasn't the dream, but yeah, it seemed simple enough.
Lee, Your story starts pre-internet. You were living in the Philippines when you met an Australian man. How did you connect?
It was way back in August 6, 1987. I was in the crossroad of my life. I was a high school teacher, and I read this ad on a newspaper in the Philippines, which is the Philippine Daily Inquirer. And it just says, you know, an Australian man wants to meet a Filipino woman who's honest and loyal, that kind of thing. I wasn't very serious about it, but I thought at the time in my homeland, it's after the People Power Revolution, when the Marcos administration was pushed out of the country. So we have the temporary government. And I was 28 at the time, and I thought about it, I give it a go, and without thinking about it, I thought I'll try, I'll correspond to him. And it started from there.
So you answered the ad. How long did you and the Australian man exchange letters for?
Well, it took me nearly 2 years. I wanted him to come to the Philippines and meet my family and meet me personally. And he was there for probably 3 times. I was very honest. He met the whole family, that kind of thing. And it took me a bit of time to ponder about it and think it over, because I have a career. I was I was teaching. But at the time, my thinking was, I told him I really wanted to have a family. And if I do have children, I want my future children to have better opportunities than what I had. And he was the same way. He was quite honest. He was a divorcee. He was only 2 years my senior. It wasn't an easy decision, but I thought, as a woman who's hitting 30, I have to make some decision at the time.
You ended up marrying him. Were you in love?
Well, I was attracted to him. You know, love is, it grows. I was attracted to him, that typical Caucasian look with the blue eyes kind of thing. And
there's your wedding photo,
yeah,
there.
No, that, and I thought, if we have children, of course, it's going to be a mix, Eurasian kind of thing.
How important was that commitment to marriage for you?
Culturally, it's in my values. Family is very important, especially in my background, my cultural background.
Was this a marriage of convenience?
Well, I would say it's mutually beneficial for both of us.
In what way for you?
I was a devoted wife and a mother. I was loyal and faithful to him, to a fault. But that kind of trust that you've given into any relationship.
And how about for your family? Was that a mutually beneficial, convenient relationship for them?
Yes, of course, because I was the oldest in the family, although they don't expect that much, but they're happy for me because I'm starting a new life, and they're thinking I will have better future when I start my own family in a much developed or first world country at the time.
Did you start a family together?
Yes, we did.
And how many children did you have?
We have 2 daughters, and they're now in their 30s.
What do you feel were the benefits for your husband?
He was married before to an Australian lady. I think it was short-lived. I think he was looking for a more stable relationship. In my case, I was a single woman, and I was a professional woman in the Philippines and very career-minded.
How often did you see your family from the Philippines?
Oh, it's not very often at the time. About 4 years before my late mother came to Australia to see my oldest daughter, who's now 35, and she was 3 years old at the time. And I had another baby in 18 months, and she's now 33.
Did your mother eventually come and live with you?
For a while she did, but eventually she immersed herself in Sydney at the time in the Filipino community, because her English language is not very fluent. So she sought company with the Filipino community in the western suburbs at the time, and eventually she got a job as a housekeeper while she's waiting to apply for permanent residency in Australia.
In the world of sugar dating, they call me a daddy. There's lots of convenient things about being a sugar daddy. It's not like a conventional relationship. It's a lot easier than meeting somebody organically. So sugar dating fulfills those gaps in your life. There was a breakup that I went through, which resulted in me turning around one morning and my family was gone. That hit me quite hard. The sugar dating was like a beautiful band-aid. It's an arrangement where you don't have to put your feelings on the line if you don't want to. As long as you've got money, in this day and age, you can have anything you want. So the arrangement styles normally start with a PPM, which is pay per meet, a certain amount of money to meet up with the lady and get to know her. From there, the negotiations can change into an allowance. In a sugar world, you can tell them exactly what you want. In reply to that, they'll tell you what they want. And if it aligns, then you've got yourself a sugar baby. So I'd say over the past 5 years, maybe I've been on 100 or 200 or more meets with different girls. The instant gratification is something that anybody can buy, but it doesn't fill the hole. You know, there's no future in it. There's no true feeling, true love in it. It's a financial exchange, really. Sex is something that we can't do without. If you're an alpha male, you want someone who's attractive, you want somebody who's going to adore you, someone who will jump at the opportunity to see you and really make you feel like you're like a man. For the girls, it would be different. It would be financials. So if they feel like they're going to be looked after, that's a prerequisite. Basically, a good sugar relationship is going to fill all of those gaps. But the essence of sugar life is sex and money.
Katia, is he right? Are sugar relationships just about sex and money?
In my opinion, no. But as we can see from the video, that is the opinion of some people. And honestly, like, there have been so many times where I've done things just for the money. And you'll have some clients that, yeah, you genuinely adore and they're just beautiful, amazing people. And then you'll have other clients that you just really don't like that much. For me, I don't want to spend hours on end in a hotel room with a man who I hate. So if you're thinking about a percentage base, I would say in sugaring or private escorting, it's probably the majority of my experiences are maybe, I don't know, like maybe 50-50, like 50% physical, and then the other 50 is, yeah, like emotional chatting, dates, but it just depends on the client. Some clients don't want to have sex at all. They just want company.
Do you get any judgment for offering that kind of service?
I'm judged every day from being a sex worker.
Jasmine, you found a sperm donor online. What arrangement did you have with him before trying to conceive?
I got some advice when I started going down this track from a friend. So I got a sperm donor contract made up. I'd heard of these before, and it set out very clearly everyone's intentions and exactly how it would roll. There was pretty much everything in that contract about who would be the parent, who would have sole parental responsibility, that the donor wouldn't be responsible for any financials. So it felt quite safe to have that.
And at that stage, did you decide to actually have sex together?
So I chose not to have sex. There's different ways, obviously, to get pregnant. I had been with a few donors before that I'd found, and one of them I did originally because I felt like a mutual connection and there was an attraction. But I soon learnt that it actually changes legally the rights of the parties if you engage in intercourse. It then means that the donor can actually have more rights if you were to end up in court and that donor was wanting more time with your child and you didn't want that, because again, that was stipulated in the contract, like that my child would only see the donor at my discretion or the child's discretion, and that you would want your donor to be on board with exactly your conditions and everything, obviously.
Would you say that agreement had convenient aspects for you?
Yeah, definitely, because it was all on my terms, so it was very convenient in that sense. So I would say it was definitely convenient.
Did you start trying to conceive straight away?
Obviously, I took some time to get to know the donor that it ended up working with. Once I'd met him and had those conversations and felt like he was the one I was going to go with, I think I tried maybe 3 to 4 months after I'd made that decision that it was going to be him.
So you'd meet up, sperm would be in the cup, self-inseminate and trying to fall pregnant over that time.
Yes, that's correct.
You tried unsuccessfully then for 5 months. After that, what did you do?
I obviously just kept trying. When I was booking in my last attempt with him, he said that he would no longer help me via artificial insemination, is what they call it. He would only help me if I engaged in sex with him.
Right, so he said he wouldn't donate his sperm unless he had penetrative sex with you.
That's right, yes.
How did you react to that?
I was pretty disgusted, pretty shocked, because I just thought that was so wrong to not stipulate. I'm cool if that's actually what your rules around how you're a donor. Like if he had just said, look, because you're this age, because he mentioned things about age, I will try 4 times AI with you, and then after 4 attempts, I will only try via sex. If he had stipulated that at the start, at least I would know his intentions and I could choose whether that would work for me or not, but he didn't. And he sort of flipped the script on me at the last minute. And finding a donor, it takes a long time, because I certainly wasn't going to do that, because I was so shocked and kind of disgusted that he was putting that on me like that, and having never said that he would, I really didn't feel great about it.
Did you agree to his demand?
No, I definitely didn't agree. I thought, well, that's it, then I can't use him anymore, because I thought that was kind of creepy and not cool. And so I thought, gosh, now I have to go and look for another donor. And you know, time was really of the essence for me for some reason. And in hindsight, I probably should have relaxed. But actually, I was pregnant, so wow. I didn't need to use him.
Right.
So a little bit of a conflicting emotion.
When you saw the results of that, what ran through your mind?
Yeah, for me, obviously, I was over the moon, right? I got my dream. It had happened, but it was so quick finding that out and him saying that. I felt really conflicted, is like the only word, you know, so happy, but also like, eek, what, ah, you know, like what just happened?
How much did you know about the man before you chose him as a sperm donor?
I think now not enough, and perhaps I could have found out more. I thought through our conversations and everything, I knew enough. And obviously you get lots of testing and all these things done, whatever you want done, they usually oblige. So I thought I'd sussed him well enough, because I hadn't had any problems with donors prior. They were all really good men and altruistic, and I didn't find out enough, clearly.
What else did you later find out about him?
Because he's got other donor children, I later reached out to some other women from that donor, and I found out that he had also pressured them into having sex.
Right.
And they didn't even do artificial, because he pressured them into having sex from the start. So that just really made me feel even more sad and conflicted about this man that now I had a child to.
Do you know how many donor children he's had?
Yeah, I did find out. I was aware when meeting him through our conversations that there was a few, but perhaps I didn't know the exact number, but it is over 20 around the world.
Lee, you married an Australian man and moved from the Philippines in the late 80s. How did people perceive your relationship?
That's one of the major challenges that I have to face when I first arrived in Australia nearly 40 years ago, because that was the time that the stereotype and stigmatization of mail order brides. And I remember at the time someone asked me, do you know Rosie Hancock? And I've got no idea who Rosie Hancock was up until I came to Australia. And then I realized she married the richest man of Australia at the time, the late Lang Hancock. And it was kind of difficult, because being a teacher and being a country girl as well, and being judged by by other people that you're coming here just to get the passport and marrying this white guy, so to speak, to get out of a country that's quite impoverished at the time.
Did you feel like you had to prove yourself even more because of those attitudes?
Yeah, for sure. It took me a bit of time to be able to conquer that fear because coming to Australia and dealing with a new culture, new way of life, and learning the colloquialism and the Australian lingo, it took me about 10 years. Although I have a bit of fluency in the English language, it's kind of very challenging. And I really have to prove myself in a way that, look, I'm not one of those girls that just married this, you know, pardon my language, fadi daddies and that kind of thing.
How did you adjust to life in your new country?
I need to really adapt really quickly because as soon as I came to Australia, we have agreed that we really wanted to start our family because we're in our 30s. This was his second marriage and at the time, I just don't want to leave it too light because you're concerned of your biological clock. And I really have to focus my energy to become a mother, just look after the family at the time.
Hanraj, you're 27. You moved to Australia from Nepal about 5 years ago. Where did you live when you first arrived in Melbourne?
When I first arrived in Melbourne, I started living with my Nepalese friends. I stayed there for around 3 years, and after that I had to make a move to regional New South Wales for my job opportunity.
How did you find living in regional New South Wales?
We are all aware of like how Australia is going through the rental crisis and house crisis at the moment. So finding a house in regional New South Wales was pretty daunting and challenging as well. I started looking for a shared accommodation, but I couldn't find any. There was only one option left of leasing a house on my own name. And yeah, so I was living on my own, alone. It was just one isolated house. Like, I was not having any company or something, you know, to share my thoughts or feelings. So yeah, it was pretty challenging to live in that regional New South Wales area, yeah.
You've since moved into a share house in regional Victoria. Who do you live with?
I started living with Kate after I got a job in Castlemaine. So it has been, yeah, pretty good experience living, sharing a house with her.
Hi, Kate.
Hi, Hanraj.
I've been living with Kate for more than a year. Honestly, I haven't expected the living together with Kate will go this well because I have never shared the accommodation with someone out of my community people.
We are different ages and we have different backgrounds. Certainly in the early days of us living together, I sort of said to Hanraj, we've got to find ways to connect if this is going to work. Communication is one of the biggest things that makes, I think, living together work. The tarot card thing is a fun thing to do.
Death. Oh my God, what is that?
Well, he was into it straight away.
Death is an ending, but it is not the end.
That was the beginning of a way that we could communicate over doing that. And now we're sort of gradually moving into a board game or two. All right.
We have different routines. So we have adapted to each our daily routines very smoothly without any trouble. So I mostly cook like Nepalese curries and lentils, rice. Kate likes spicy food, but my food is way too spicy, so we don't really share meals.
In a meal that he makes, he'll put in, you tell him how much you put into a curry.
5-6 chilies, and it's a spicy green chili, it's not a normal chili, so yeah.
And he has that every night.
Yes. We have different tastes as well, maybe because of different countries and, you know, things. I haven't really tasted Kate's food, like maybe...
Pizza?
Oh yeah, pizza, yes. I have learned how to make pizza with Kate, to be honest. I didn't know that before.
The sharing relationship that Hans Raj and I have together in this house, it works exceptionally well, even though we do have a lot of differences. And I think that is because of respect, a foundational respect for each other and just as humans, as people. And so gender and age and all those things doesn't really come into it. And it's really a joy having that experience, really.
Yeah. That proves it, that even the differences in everything, you can make it work, sharing a house.
Cate, you're single and also like to live with a housemate. How many housemates would you have lived with over the years?
I'd probably say maybe about 50.
What do you like about having a housemate?
I just think it's really important that we share. I think there's a lot to be had by just having somebody else around the house, actually.
Financially, do you need to be splitting your rent with someone else?
Yes, I do. Yes, yep. That's part of it for me, yeah.
Is sharing your home convenient for you?
If I had the choice, so if I could live on my own rather than sharing, no, I think I'd still share. It's just a matter of seeing the value in doing that.
How did you and Hanraj connect?
We got it on Gumtree, the platform Gumtree, but also Hanraj had registered on the Room Xchange. And I'd actually got to the point of interviewing people where I felt like I didn't have the confidence, actually, to ask the right questions. I had a couple of different things happen and I thought, I'd love somebody else to come in and do this for me. And that's what the Room Xchange does. So essentially, they vet the flatmates coming in. So I think it was because Hanraj actually registered on there, we sort of hooked up that way. It's fantastic.
Did you have some must-haves in a share house arrangement?
I like to have a clean house. And I live pretty quietly, I guess.
And how's been living with Cate for you, Hanraj?
Yeah, it has turned out to be a pretty positive experience for me.
Is this relationship convenient for you?
It just comes with, like, mutual understanding, respect for each other, you know, and also how you adapt to each other's differences. Mm. That's what I think. So that's... I think it's a convenient relationship for me, yes.
Yeah. Cate, how about you?
Because I'm older, just having somebody... And I live in a very safe area, but yeah, it's definitely good having somebody else around just for, well, even if he fell over or something, you know, just having someone there, I think it's a good thing.
Should more of us be open to sharing our homes with strangers?
Oh, absolutely, definitely. I live in an area, Castlemaine, where there's so many people who've, even if they're in relationships, you know, they're in big houses, they're getting older, one of them's going to die eventually. And I've been sort of saying to them how good this sort of thing is to do and that they should consider when they get older to maybe rent out one of their rooms in their house. They might have a four-bedroom house. It's very difficult for a lot of people to even consider that. Mm. Most people won't. And I think that's what we need to bring into conversations a lot more, to bring other people maybe into your household. We need to get over these things of, oh, I could never share with someone because I couldn't have them sharing my bathroom. Oh, I don't want their germs. You know, things like this. I think there's a lot that needs to be done, but it can be fun, you know, and I think also different cultures, this is a good example, you know, like that brings another element into sharing.
Lawson, 2 years ago you had a different kind of housemate, your ex-wife. Why did you stay living with her?
Our arrangement during our marriage, she worked full-time, I worked part-time and was full-time stay-at-home dad. And upon separating, we sold the family home and, well, on paper, I looked terrible. I was only working 2 days a week, so it was hard to prove finances to real estate. And as much as I tried, very competitive rental market, I put it to her that I was worried about the outlook, that it wasn't looking very well, and I asked if it was possible if I could rent a room from her temporarily.
Did you have any other options apart from that, Lawson?
Keep trying, keep looking. I mean, I don't have family or friends in Brisbane. I definitely wanted to stay close to my daughter, as we share a daughter. And, I want to be part of her life.
How did your ex react to that living suggestion?
I think it's one of those things, we're both pretty pragmatic people, so when it comes down to it, she said, even though it's not ideal, it is what it is.
So what was it like subleasing a room from your former wife?
not ideal, but it had its conveniences. It was lovely being able to spend every day with my daughter because I'd handle school pickups and essentially I'd do the cooking and cleaning. It was like nothing changed except for I was in a separate room of the house.
Did this arrangement make it hard to move on after the breakup?
When I was finally ready to rejoin the dating world, it was a deal breaker in quite a few circumstances.
How did it work when it came to new relationships and dating for you both?
I told myself that, moving on is what the goal was. When she was dating, I told myself, mind your own business, she's got her life, you've got yours. And I appreciated the same privacy when I started dating.
They probably two most memorable years of my life, two most healing years of my life too.
Hi guys.
I found my soulmate and my best friend. It was probably the most important time in my life.
Looking good. Thanks, mate.
It gave me confidence as a mother, gave me confidence to even go out and date again.
All right, dinner's up. Who's hungry?
Yes, please.
I met Trent just over a year into living with Nikki.
Cheers, darling.
And that was always the goal, to be in a committed relationship. So it was exciting, but it was also really sad to let go of this beautiful thing that we had.
Stacey started joking that I was her husband, but then when Trent came along, we joked and we said, well, he's H2 because I was here first.
Yeah.
So for a while there, Stacey had two husbands.
There was a bit of a battle going on for a while there. Yeah.
Yeah, there was absolutely plenty of times when I just wanted to run back to Nikki's house.
Our house.
Yeah, I know.
There was also a lot of playing and splashing in the pool.
Yeah.
A lot of sleepovers in each other's rooms. A lot of dressing up in my high heels.
I remember that.
Yeah. Yeah.
The fashion show. Our girls both now have someone else that is like a mum to them. Mm. Without even blinking, Stace could ring me and say, can you have Halo? And I'd be like, yep, no worries, whatever you need. And Halo would come here seamlessly without any worries at all. And I think vice versa with Portia as well. She'd go to your place without even worrying.
We'll come over and swim and hang out, and it definitely still means a lot here. Still 100% my spiritual home. You're not allowed to move out.
I'm not allowed to move out.
Because I need to be able to come back and visit, okay?
Okay, I'll stay forever. It was really soon after you moved out that we started having the sleepovers, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was a matter of weeks.
What's happening?
Girls' night.
Girls' night. See you, boys.
Again.
See ya.
Didn't actually realise how much I needed to live with this beautiful woman until I live with her. So yeah, absolutely, it started as a convenient relationship.
Girls, movie? Yes.
But very quickly we developed this beautiful friendship that, yeah, was more than just convenience.
Eventually we just realised we couldn't live without each other anyway.
Stacey and Nikki, you say the 2 years you shared a house and co-parented your daughters were the best years of your lives. Come on, there must have been a few downsides.
Nope.
Oh, wow. Sounds like the only downside was actually moving out.
It was really sad moving out.
Yeah,
it was. It was.
Why do you think it worked so well?
Maybe a bit of luck.
A little bit of luck.
Our personalities just gelled so well. We became best friends, so yeah. It was a match made in heaven.
Yeah.
Cate and Hanraj, you're still happily sharing a home together. How long do you think you'll continue to stay, Hanraj?
So to be honest, the future is always uncertain. But as far as, I have a job in Castlemaine, I haven't thought of moving out of the house. So, yeah, we never know, when the circumstances change and demands. So, yeah, as the life unfolds, I'm ready to adapt to the things, yes.
Cate, how long do you think it'll continue?
He can stay as long as he likes. But he's got a lot coming up, young guy.
Why do you think the relationship is still working so conveniently?
I just think we both understand what we want from it, actually. And also, I think we're both quite similar people. I think that we're both really independent. It's really just like two independent people living in the same house. It's quite different, but people need to know that that can be done.
Do you share the housework?
Yeah, definitely. He's great at all the cleaning.
Is there something about Hanraj which makes him easy to live with?
Well, look, if I compare him to other housemates, I hope this doesn't sound racial or anything, but I've mainly probably shared with English, Western type people. They can sort of, we all carry this sort of privilege in a way. So if I said to someone or left it organically to them to do cleaning, they might say, oh, you know, I don't want to do that, or why should I do that? Whereas I find with him, he'll actually say, can I do that? He'll come up and say that first. It's really quite different. I haven't experienced that for quite some time.
Lawson, 2 years ago, you subleased a room from your ex-wife. Did you plan on that being an ongoing arrangement?
Definitely not. The plan was to get on my feet, find a full-time job, find myself a suitable place to live and vacate the premises.
In the end, it was your ex that moved out. Why?
I couldn't get a place. No one had touched me. And also, I said, like, after getting a good full-time job, I said, look, it's going to be 3 months before real estate will even consider me, like, because that's the kind of employment history that they're chasing. So I said to her, look, your relationship that you've started is going quite well. If it's moving the way where you guys want to live together, maybe if you want that to happen sooner, you could find a new place.
Right, so she left and then signed the lease to you so it could be yours?
Yeah, that's right.
Do you live alone in that house now?
No, I've invited a friend. We share a house together. And I have my daughter 50-50, which is absolutely fantastic.
Jasmine, you went on to have a child you conceived with donor sperm. Your child is still only young. How much do they know about their biological father?
Yeah, they know, and that's why I did it the way I did, because I wanted my child to know their donor dad, their biological father. So we have talked about him. They've seen photos of the donor holding my child when they were young, and my child is very aware and has seen the photos and really knows about him and talks about him, because when I mention him, my child has started just now at this age starting to instigate, oh, maybe we should see him. And obviously that was the whole reason why I went into it, so we could have that kind of transparency.
How do you feel about those conversations as your child gets older?
I guess because of what's happened and what I know and how I feel about the donor, I feel really conflicted. And of course I will allow that meeting to happen in good time, and whatever relationship blossoms from that, it's not going to be something that happens a lot, I feel.
Does your child ever say, hey, I want a sibling?
Yes, but obviously I'm now even older, and the whole thing with that donor, I mean, if I was ever going to do it, I imagined I would do it again with the same donor. It would only make sense, but I don't think I will go down that road now.
Has this become more complicated than convenient for you?
Yes, it's become definitely more complicated, unfortunately, not as convenient as I thought it would be.
Lee, you've lived here for nearly 40 years after marrying an Australian man that you met through a newspaper ad. You described your marriage as mutually beneficial. Is it still benefiting you now?
Oh, yes, I would say yes. My tribe has increased. We have two daughters together, and I would say they grow up very responsible young women. I've got three grandchildren.
Wow. Your marriage ended after 30 years. What does the future hold for you now?
In Australia, we have that thing, you know, this is an expression, such is life. And, you know, life doesn't end up in fairy tales, so to speak. This movie by Julia Roberts, Eat, Love and Pray. I reckon I'm doing Eat. Not so much with love, but I love everyone. I don't have any hatred in my heart. And I think that's what I'm doing. And just exploring whatever's left in my lifetime and trying to make the most of it one day at a time.
Lee, thank you so much. And thank you all for being here tonight. That's all we have time for. Thank you too for watching. You can catch up on this episode or any others on SBS On Demand. I'll see you next time.